watching us live around the world. God bless you. Come on, give him a big hand here from the Bahamas, where God lives. And those of you watching us in Canada, I know it's snowing. I was in Detroit just about 3 days ago, and it was 4 feet of snow. And I know those of you who are from Michigan are happy to be here, because the weather is nice and the temperatures yesterday was 79 degrees. So we have a great time here in the Bahamas where God lives. I want to speak to you on the topic, please. Rediscovering the value, the purpose, and the power of the family. We're going to be focusing today briefly on understanding the principles and benefits of the institution of the family. The institution that we call the family. I'm going to move fairly quickly. I want the young people to listen especially carefully. If you are married, please take notes. If you are not married, take notes twice. Okay? If you are divorced, you want to get duplicate copies of everything. But this is important to understand why the family is so important to God. And I'm glad that we have our children in this meeting today, because we want our children to be a part of this environment of how important it is for the family to be together. Let's begin, first of all, talking about the family and to see how important the family is to God's plan for this planet. The family, first of all, is the oldest human institution that exists. It is the oldest human institution. And that's why we can't improve on it, because no matter what we do, we cannot improve on what God laid down as a foundation. Secondly, the family is God's ideal institution. And I focus on the word ideal, because when God created the family, he had a specific structure in mind that was to be defined as family. Thirdly, and it's very important to understand this, the family is the cure for all of our social, psychological, emotional, and spiritual ills in our society. Everything that's going wrong in your country can be traced back to a problem in the family. In the Bahamas here where we live, and many of you are from other places, but in the Bahamas where we live, we are having a tremendous social problem going on right now that's emerging in our nation. Problems like increased violent crime in a place called Paradise. We have increased rapes taking place in our country, which was kind of weird in our nation in 20, 30 years ago. We've got divorce rates that are out of control. We have people who are having their children abused and incest taking place among family members. And most of the problems in our country can be traced back to bitterness that comes from a family that didn't work. Young people in prison today are angry at their parents or their father who was never there. And you find young men taking their anger out on society. Young women taking their anger out against their mother and their father by abusing themselves or leaving home or abandoning their relationships with the family or even creating subculture families. A subculture family is what we call a gang, where young people meet together because of a common agreement. And some of those meetings are not healthy for society. These are very dangerous. Another point to remember is that the solution to all of our national situations, all of our problems nationally, could be traced back to a solution in the family. And that's why I'm so happy to focus on family today. Because if we don't get the family right, we cannot get our nation right. The family is the key to a stable, productive, and sensitive, healthy nation. The family is. No government program can heal the nation better than the family. No amount of money that is spent by government can correct the national conditions in a country better than restoring the family. And in many cases, many government programs gravitate against family development because they focus sometimes on the separation of the family more than the coming together and the strengthening of the family institution. Therefore, I want to give you what I call the 10 fundamental principles of the family. You want to write these down. There are 10 fundamental principles of the family that you should remember. The first one is that the family is the foundational unit for reproduction. Now, we hear a lot of talk about this lately. We have questions about same-sex marriages, where we have two women wanting to create a legal marriage and then create what they call a family. We got two males talking about coming together legally in a matrimonial relationship and say they're creating a family. Well, my problem with this is that according to the way God planned the human development, the family is the only perfect environment for reproduction, because it is the only qualified unit for effective and total development. When a child is born into a ideal family, it is very rare for you to experience a child who has social problems. My mother and father, and my father's here today, had 11 children. And all of us are sane. No one is a criminal. And we were not rich. We were born into a family, 11 kids, in one of the poorest part of our country, in the midst of a whole lot of difficulties, where there was a lot of poverty, a lot of stress and strain and frustration. Matter of fact, where we were born is where one of the first gangs in the Bahamas was conceived. And on both sides of our houses were drinking bar rooms. How come my mother and father produced such good children like myself and others here? My mother and father produced young people who are respectable and who respect people. Because the home was the most stable place for our development. Now, I know that God has blessed many of you single parents and your kids came out well. But I tell you that there are still some defects that you probably don't want to deal with. Because when there is a dysfunctional family, there will be, in some unconscious ways, some defects developed, because people need whatever God put in the family structure. It is the ideal place for reproduction. Number two, the family is the prototype of society. When God created a family, He created a small society. So if you want to know what a society looks like, study the families. Number three, society is only as strong as the family. No matter what we say about our country, about economic development and projects going on and investors coming in and all the good stuff we're talking about, we got folks going to these jobs who came from homes that are full of difficulties. As a matter of fact, I was talking to one of the general managers of a hotel, and he said that he needs me to come in and talk to his staff, because most of his staff are coming to work either angry, bitter, or just out of a fight. And they're trying to get these people to love the customer or to love the tourists that come. And these people come from homes where there's broken families, there's beatings, there's incest, there's frustration, and they're trying to be productive on the job. And that's why there's so much difficulty, like drinking and alcoholism and drugs on the job, because these young people are coming out of homes where there is no structure and guidance and sense of belonging, and they find it somewhere else with friends that are doing activities that are not healthy. The family is the key to the strength of society. Number four, society is a reflection of the condition of the family. You can tell what's happening in the family by what's happening in the nation. You study our society, and it's a clear indication of what's happening in our families. Because you cannot produce a nation better than your families. Your family is a collection of nations, and nations rather a collection of families. So if the family is sick, the nation will be sick. If the family is disintegrated, the nation will be disintegrated. If the family is frustrated, the nation will be frustrated. If there's anger in the family, it'll show up in the community. And so the family determines the condition of the nation. Number five, the purpose of the family is to secure society. God created the family to protect society. We should not focus so much on society. We should focus on the family. Because when you focus on the family, you automatically strengthen society. And that's why any nation that builds a strong family concept and a strong family priority, you'll find that nation prospering. There'll be less poverty, less crime, less depression. Matter of fact, one of the weird things you should study is the Jewish communities. Because they place family above government. They place family above education. They place family above prosperity. And that's why those Jewish communities anywhere in the world, you find them prospering. There's low crime rates among the Jewish people. Why? Because they focus on family. Well, number six is kind of an explanation for that. The purpose of the family is to secure society, and the sanctity of the family is the bedrock for human survival. If we don't sanctify the family again, respect it, we are going to have a nation that is disintegrating. I put it to you, number seven, the family is not a product of the state. Say amen. The government cannot create a family, and the government did not produce the family. And we got to be very serious about this, because sometimes we want the government to bring up our kids, government to correct our husbands who ain't paying family responsibilities. We want the government to take care of our daycare needs. We want the government to punish our kids for us. We want the government to teach our kids for us. And so we basically have kids, and then we dump them on the doorstep of the government and say, educate them, discipline them, correct them, protect them while I go to work and make some money. The state did not create the family. As a matter of fact, what's even more real is that a family is a product of the state. No, the state is a product of the family. In other words, the government is only as good as the family that produced them. Some of you may wonder, okay, why are politicians corrupt? Check the family. In other words, you cannot produce a government better than the families in that society. So we have government leaders who commit adultery, who shackle people. Well, study the family that guy came from, or that lady came from. You'll find that the family cannot produce a state better than itself. So if you want a better government, you got to have a better what? Family. Many government leaders in these countries throughout the Caribbean and the world are corrupt, and they have moral questions, values that are so low. But where do you get your values from and your morality from? From your family, not from the government. So when they enter government, they bring their values with them, and now we get national immorality. The family produces the state. Number nine, the dissolution of the family, therefore, is the dissolution of the state. In other words, when you destroy the family, you really destroy the country. So society can be destroyed by destroying the family. And that's why there's so much attack going on the family. It is illegal custody, therefore, number 10, when the state becomes the parent. I'm going to say this again. It is illegal custody when the state becomes the parent. It is sad that the government is getting involved in private business in the house. When your government tells you you cannot spank your kid, that government is becoming too nosy. Can I hear an amen somewhere in this place? When you correct your child and they want to call it child abuse, that government is becoming too involved in family development. Now, we are against incest. We are against child abuse. We understand that. But we are not against you as a parent applying reasonable discipline to your child without the government putting their nose in your business. My mother and father, my father's here today, and I don't think you can produce a son better than me. I mean, look at this son. Stand up, daddy. Stand up, daddy. This man and his wife produce people like me and spank us all the way to sanity. Give my daddy a big hand. One of the most amazing sounds in my life, I'll never forget, is the jingle of his belt when I knew I did something wrong. You could hear it coming down the hall of that house. And you knew that you were about to become anointed to receive correction. You'd pray for extra padding on your hip. Why? They didn't care what government says. They were following the laws of God. It says that foolishness is bound up in the heart of a child, and only the rod of correction will take it out. You cannot counsel mismanagement out of kids. You can't counsel kids into good manners. Why? The Bible says we got foolishness in our hearts, and only the rod can get it out. And I think God must be smart to figure that out himself. So when the state becomes the parent, we are in trouble. And some of us have dumped our kids on the state. Let the government take care of them. Let the government correct them. Let the government. And then when you go to school, the teacher gets in trouble because she tries to bring some order to your kid who you made disobedient. If your child can't respect authority at home, he won't respect authority in the class. And so don't blame that student, or I'm sorry, that teacher, when that teacher tries to bring order and correct your son. Whoop the kid. I told the teachers when my son and daughter were growing up, my daughter's here today, she's a graduate of Oral Roberts University, bless her heart. But when she was, when they went to school, we told the teachers right away, now look, if they behave, spank first, call later. Say it with me. Spank first, call later. In other words, don't call me and ask me if you can spank them. Because they can get a second spanking when they come home. For making me ashamed in front of all them students. They y'all talking to me? The family must not abdicate its responsibility and give it to the government. The government is not the parent of your children. So don't let the government take over your life. Let's talk about the foundation of the family very quickly. The family is the first form of society established and instituted in human history. It's the first institution. And by the way, the second one is important. The family is the prototype of society. And therefore, society is a reflection of the condition of the family. And this makes me understand that society is only as strong as the family. So we want society to be strong. We've got to strengthen the family. The family institution is a product of natural law. Everybody say natural law. Write this one down, please. This one is very important. What is the family? It's a product of natural law. It reflects the principles of nature. What I mean by that is this. God, you know, God never quite made a statement about the family in the book of Genesis. He didn't. God never talked about, you know, I am now going to create a family. He didn't. What God made was a male, and he made a female. And then he said, what? Be fruitful. God says, look, if a male and female get together, something will happen. Naturally. They're going to have children. That produces what? A family. In other words, God didn't have to talk about something that happens naturally, by natural law. I'm saying this for a reason. The true family is a product of natural law. Anything else is a concoction. In other words, a male could decide to adopt another male as a spouse. I use the word adopt, not marry. And they could then adopt some kids and say that that's a family. That ain't no family. That's a contraption. Y'all should clap right there. Two men cannot naturally produce a child, which means it is not a natural product. Very important. Two females with two vaginas cannot produce a child. So don't tell me that you're creating a family, you adopt. You know, Rosie O'Donnell the other day came here, you know, talking about she have a family cruise. And all them is women. And they adopting black kids. And two white ladies. I mean, that confused the kid right away. So who do you call daddy? I mean, I got to have a daddy somewhere. I got to look at two women and say, okay, one of y'all is daddy. Confusing me. No, that's a contraption. Contraption. It's a con job. It's a trap. And you should shun it. Absolutely. Cannot be a family. Why? It is not natural. If you're going to imitate something, imitate nature effectively. And that's why adoption is so natural. Adoption by a father and mother of a child is a natural imitation of God's program. You got a male and female and a child. The kid is still protected because the imitation is based on an original. Can I hear an amen? That's why it's important to understand that the family is not a product of government, nor legislation, or social science or religion. In other words, no government should have the authority or the right to legislate or attempt to legislate that they can create what a family is. That's why in our constitution, they are attempting now to do what they call reform. I want to speak here publicly in the name of Jesus. This going on TV all over the world, that no government can legislate what a family looks like. No policy in government can turn a man into a woman, and a woman into a man, and two men into a husband and wife. No legislation can do that. So God is very clear. Nature itself produces family institution. And when you violate nature, you cannot produce family. Two men cannot produce a child, so forget it. It's not a family, it's an arrangement. It's an arrangement. I say to you that the key to building a strong family is very simple. First of all, family was not taught as a principle in the beginning because it was a natural product of nature. And that's why God didn't have to teach it. Number two, it's very important. Proverbs 24 verse 3 says this. Write this down, please. It says, by wisdom a house is built, through understanding it is established, and through knowledge its rooms are filled with rare and beautiful treasure. God says, look, you're going to build a strong family. You don't need sex first. Look at the list. He said, to build a strong family, first you need to have wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. And then the family becomes a beautiful, wonderful place. So that's why we have Family Day. Family Day is the beginning of a revolution in this nation and in your country where you came from to take back this message that we are taking the family back. We're going to grab hold of it and say, look, this is God's property. We're going to build it the way God says it's supposed to be built. No one is going to tell us what the family looks like as a kingdom people. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
Can I hear a loud amen?
Amen?
The family is God's property. And he left it in the hands of those who serve him. And we must be the ones to determine how that family looks. And he already laid it out in Proverbs 24. It's a place where we learn it through wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. The purpose for the family. Write this down. Very important list. What is the purpose for the family? First of all, the purpose of the family is to secure society. God is not concerned about your nation if your families are intact. Because the family secures society. Number two, the sanctity of the family is not an institution of the state. In other words, the state doesn't make the family holy or special. So it doesn't. It's not the family, it's not the state's prerogative, nor their responsibility to say, okay, this is now a family. No, the state's supposed to recognize God's institution and protect it. Keep it sanctified. Oh, I need to say this. The state's job is to make sure the family remains sanctified. In other words, the state should not do anything that will encourage the breaking up of the family. There are three deals in the world. There's the ordeal, there's let's make a deal, then there's the ideal. The ideal is what God created. The ordeal is what you may have experienced. The let's make a deal is what you're trying to correct. Society doesn't have the responsibility. God has placed that upon himself. He said, look, you follow my orders and you'll have a healed society. So the government must protect what God created, not make arrangements for its disintegration. And that's why it's very important for government to institute checks and balances even in the divorce courts. I just read something in the papers, in the newspaper, in U.S. News and World Today. It's a beautiful story about a state in the U.S. where the attorney general of that state and a group of his colleagues got together, and they decided that before they allow any court to produce a divorce paper to anybody, they got to go through 6 months of training to get themselves back together first. I thought it was a good policy. In other words, you come to this court to get divorced, before we give it to you, go to counseling for 6 months. And if it doesn't work, come back to us, we'll consider it. And they say that the divorce rate has already dropped by 40%. Because folks know they need to go for help before they even come to the courts. That's the government protecting the family. The easier you make divorce, the easier you make disintegration of family take place. And when you destroy the family, you destroy society. That's why it's so tough for you to get a divorce in this church. Because we don't tolerate it. And if you got a divorce, it was because somebody didn't want to give in to the word. It's the last advice we would give anybody. Because it's not God's will for that family to fall apart. Now don't forget, you got your ordeal, your ideal, then let's make a deal. But God's ideal is always the standard. Number three, the family produces the state, and therefore it is illegal custody when the state becomes the parent. When you dissolve the family, you dissolve the society, and every social mental problem in the world and in your city is related to something that went wrong in the family. Now let me talk about what the family is by definition. I took this from the Greek New Testament. Interesting word. The word family is the word oikos. in the Greek language, in the New Testament, and it actually means a dwelling or a house, to dwell or to be at home. In other words, the Greek concept of family, as used in the New Testament, is a place where you feel at home, where you find your spot, you find your place. At home means to fit. In other words, a family is a place where God created for you that you just fit in this place. And that's why a mother and father can produce a child. It just fits right in the middle of them. It's difficult for you to get a better fit than a good family. The Hebrew word in the Old Testament is the word bayat. And bayat or bayat actually means lineage or household or including servants. It includes even dependents who may not even be born from you. In other words, a household, a family in the Hebrew language is everyone that lives in your house. That means if you got a housekeeper or a slave or a servant or you got a maintenance person, if they are part of your house, they are part of your family. That means that if anyone works for you, listen carefully, they must be considered as part of your family. Which means that they have to have the same values, the same moral standards as you have for your home. So when you got someone watching over your kids when you go to work, they should have the same values you have. I'm saying something important. Why? They're part of my family. I remember my eldest brother who's here today, one of our elders, he was telling me a story. He told a group a story one time, how his little girl went to a daycare center. And when the little girl came back, she was just like 3 years old, cursing four-letter words, man. He said he almost died because he never said them kind of things in his house. The little girl is cursing these foul language words. And he says, my goodness, my little girl, where'd you learn that? And she said, school. It was a daycare center. Went back and checked, other parents had the same problem. And the person who was in charge of the daycare was cussing up a breeze. In other words, when you leave your child with someone, whoever that someone is a part of your family, God says. So you got to check and investigate and make sure before you give people your most precious possession, which is your children. Can I hear an amen? If you got a housekeeper, don't just see if they can iron and clean. See where their head is at. Are they born again? Do they have the same values that you hold and respect? Why? Because when you leave those kids for 8 hours in their care, they are molding your child. I like what God said to Abraham. He said, Abraham, I love you and I will keep no secret from you. Why? He said, because you will teach your family and your servants the commandments of God. And because you will do this, I will bless you. In other words, Abraham made sure that the guy who cut the lawn believed in the God he served. Don't just abandon your kids to anybody. The family, therefore, is a dwelling created as a result of marriage between a male and female who becomes parents that produces or adopt children committed to parental care and nurturing of the same to reproduce themselves after themselves just like themselves. In other words, the family is a place where God put children to reproduce them after its kind. If you got corrupt parents, you produce corrupt kids. You got immorality in the parents, you got immorality in the kids. And so God gave you your greatest gift, and that is children as a family. The family does some things. Look at Exodus chapter 12. Out loud, read it together, everybody. Out loud, go. Tell the whole, come on, read it together. Come on, everybody. Tell the whole community, Israel, that on the 10th day of this month, each man is to take a lamb for his family for one for each household. Read on again. If anyone does not provide for his family, and especially for his immediate family, he has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. This is from scriptures. Notice God told the people of Israel, he said, when you come to bring a lamb, you don't bring a lamb for yourself. You cover your whole family. God is thinking always family. He thinks in terms of family. And if you come before God, you must bring your family. I'm so glad that you came in here today and you brought your family to the Lamb. Matter of fact, you ain't bringing a lamb for the family. You brought the family to the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ, today. You should never leave home without your family when you go to worship God. That's why it's so good that you're here with your children and your young teenagers and your parents and your grandparents. What a wonderful thing to obey God. And he says, you must provide for your immediate family. And by the way, it's so important to remember Psalm 68 out loud. Go, read. God sets the lonely. Come on, together. God sets the lonely in families. He leads forth the prisoners with singing. But the rebellious live in a sun-scorched land. When you are having a problem of loneliness, you don't need prayer. What do you need?
A family.
Many of our young people in our society, and older people too, are suffering from loneliness. And when you are lonely, you don't need to shack up. You need what?
A family.
Because you can be lonely with someone who is using you. You need a family. You need a stable environment if you feel lonely. And that's why it's important out of this family day, I hope that there will be many of you who will open your homes to adopt young people, to adopt older singles, to adopt folks who have been through difficulty. Why? They don't need to be avoided. They need a family to be stabilized. Very important. Look at Numbers 14, verse 18. Go. The Lord is slow to anger, abounding in love, and forgiving sin and rebellion. Yet he does not leave the guilty unpunished. He punishes the children for the sins of the fathers to the third and the fourth generation. My God, what a frightening thing. Let me tell you something. God says the male in the family can affect four generations. That means the average man in this room is carrying in him right now the power to affect his great, 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 great grandchild who's unborn. The reality is, many of you men and women are suffering from actions taken by your great, great, great grandfather four generations ago that are affecting your life right now. Some of your problems that you have, you're wondering, where did I get this idea from or this desire from? It came from something that your forefathers did. God says the sin of a man can affect his great, great, great grandson. That means if your great, 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 great grandfather was homosexual, you're wondering why you got tendencies. A spirit entered your family four generations ago, and your great, great, great grandfather was a homosexual, and now you're struggling with that spirit as a lesbian. Maybe your grandfather, great, grand, great grandfather was a domestic abuser. He beat his wife. And you're wondering why you are so angry at the woman you're living with. And you love her, but you keep getting angry. There's a spirit that entered your generation four generations ago that's causing you to have this kind of spirit. Some of you fine young men who love God are committing adultery. And you say, why do I still have a desire to commit adultery? Why do I keep falling into the trap? Sometimes I repent, and then I go back. I repent, I go back. You check your great, 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 great grandfather. If he slept around with women and having all kinds of extra curricular activities, you'll find that spirit is in your family, God says, and it comes upon you even to the fourth generation. Some of you women are marrying men who are trapped by a spirit. He looks good, he smells good, dresses good, but he's carrying four generations of problems. And when you marry him, you marry that problem. That's the power of a family. What do you do with that? That means that those men need to have those spirits broken of them by the power of the blood in Jesus' name. You got to be delivered from your great-great-great-grandfather's activities. Today, before we leave this building, we are going to break those generational curses from your life, sir. God's going to bless you to be a good man and a good father and a good husband. You're going to be a righteous man. Can I hear an amen? Because for the sake of your unborn children, you got to make it right. There's some stuff that your father did secretly you don't know anything about. Maybe he's an alcoholic. Maybe he was on drugs, whatever. And here you are struggling with the same spirit. You wonder, where did I get this from? Why do I always want to drink when I get angry? Because that's what your grandfather did. And it needs to be broken. And it will be broken today in Jesus' name. Can I hear an amen? Now, how do family preserve values? This is where God gave us responsibility. Read out loud, please. Psalm 78, verse 21 says what? I will open my mouth in parables. I will utter hidden things, things from of old, what we have heard and known, what our fathers have told us. See, you were supposed to be taught values from your fathers long ago, not from your school teacher. You don't leave the students in the class to be brought up by the teacher to learn values and morals. Matter of fact, it gets better. Look at this. Read out loud, verse 4. We will not hide them from their children. We will tell the next generation the praiseworthy deeds of the Lord, His power, and the wonders He has done. In other words, you are supposed to communicate to your children the values that God taught you from your fathers. And some of your fathers didn't do a good job. God has started in your generation. That's why it's important to see so many men here today, because your job is to transfer values and morals and standards to your children. No teacher is given the responsibility to bring my children up morally. That's my job. The values that I respect, the things that I value, are supposed to be communicated to my children by me as a parent or a grandparent. I challenge you today to take responsibility for the kid you're about to have. Because when you have that child, God is saying, look, whatever that kid learns have to come from you, not from the students and the class or from the teacher in the class. My kids went to school and challenged the teachers. I was so happy to hear that many times. My kid would say, no, that's not what my father taught me. And the teacher would call me and say, oh, your son, your daughter, there's something else. I said, yeah, that's right, there's something else. Because what they learn, they take to school. They don't bring stuff home from school. Shout amen, somebody. The family begins in the incubator of your home, not in the classroom or not on the streets with a gang. It's very important. Look at this important statement about generational power of the family. The educational role of the family is shown here in Psalm 78. God leaves education up to the family first. Read it aloud together. Go. He decreed statutes for Jacob and established the law in Israel, which he commanded our forefathers to teach their children. Look at verse 6. Go. So the next generation would know them, even the children yet to be born, and they in turn would tell their children. God said, look, I want education to take place in the home. And it has to be taught in a way that they would take it to their kids. You know, I expect, let me just say this. If you want to measure if you are a good parent, you never measure your parenthood by your children. You measure it by your grandchildren. If you want to know how good you were as a parent, study your grandchildren, not your children. If you did a good job, it'll show up in your grandkids. If you did a bad job, it'll show up in your grandkids. That's what God said. I like what God said. God says, a good man leaves an inheritance, not to his children, but to his children's children. See, your grandkids will tell you how well you taught your children. If your grandkids come home cussing, you know how well you did with your kids. If your grandkids are disobedient to authority, it shows what you taught your children. So your grandkids are your big test, not your kids. And God says, whatever you teach your children, you teach it with the understanding that they will teach their children that are yet unborn. The power of the family is to transfer morals to generations ahead of them. Read verse 7 out loud, please. Then they would put their trust in God and would not forget his deeds, but would keep his commands. Let me tell you something. If you want to secure your children's future spiritually, you got to start right now. Your grandchildren will not turn from God if you teach your children the values of your love for God. My father taught us about God. And my daddy, every single Sunday, we had altar. In the mornings, we had prayer meeting. I mean, these 11 little nappy-haired kids, always together, having prayer meeting in the house and making sure we read the Bible, and he would read the word to us, and my mother always reading the Bible to us, and I'm like, my God, but now I'm doing the same thing to my kids, and now my kids are going to do the same thing to their kids. In other words, they will know the God of their father. Some of you single parents, I know how rough it is without a man in the house. That's why God has given me to be a husband to you and a father to you. Your kids should know what a man looks like when they look at your pastor. Amen. Because you see, the kids need a role model. You know, the greatest thing my father taught me, sitting here today, and I say to you before, Daddy, the greatest thing you taught me is to love God and love my wife. My father loved my mother for 51 years of marriage. 53. He corrected me. 53 years of marriage. He was married to one woman for 53 years. He showed me how to love a woman. So my wife, you straight, baby. You straight, 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 straight. I asked my daughter, and she's here today, and she's going to brush you on this. I asked her, I said, what kind of man you want? She said, I want a man just like you. So whoever you are, brother, you got to start working hard. Watch me good. He taught me how to love my wife. Now I'm teaching my daughter how a man's supposed to love her. This is how you transfer values
In the family.
How many kids are learning how to slap women? How to curse at women? How to abuse women? From their fathers in the house. Let's talk about this kingdom education program of the family. Very important. The family is God's institution for education. And number two, the family is God's system of transfer for values. Number three, the family is God's program for instilling morality. Number four, the family is God's source of establishing righteous traditions and customs. Number five, the family has the role of never being substituted by the state. God never told the government to teach the family. Nowhere in Scripture. He said, let the family teach the family. And that's important. Many of us send our kids to school and hope they come out right. The school can't teach your family to be proper children. They must take those morals to school. All the school is supposed to give them is information, not morality. No values should be taught by the school. They can't teach values in the school. It comes from what they watch and see that you value. In other words, if you sit down and watch television 5 hours a day, every day, you're telling the kids you value TV. So don't blame them when they sit down and watch TV for 5 hours. If you value talking on the phone for hours, talking to some friend for hours, then your kid say, oh, you value telephone, so I'm going to talk on the phone too. You value your cigarette. I mean, every time you get, you always puff it. Kids say, oh, you value that smoking thing. So I'm going to value that. That's how you transfer values, by what they keep seeing you value. You put value on something. You value argument. Always fussing, always fussing. Say, okay, that's how you solve problems, you fight. See, they're picking up values from you. The family is so powerful that it teaches value even when it's not intentional. You tell your kid, don't smoke like I smoke. Wait a minute, you're confusing me. You value cancerettes, and you tell me not to value it. The Bible says to fathers that you must not exasperate your children, which means do not have a double standard for your kids. Say one thing and do another thing. Impossible to bring them up properly. Matter of fact, the last one is important. The state may transfer information, but not morality and values. When you leave it up to the country to teach your kids good manners, you are in trouble already. Matter of fact, the only manners that our state teaches our kids is in prison. They tell them when to get up, when to bathe, when to eat, when to work, when to go to bed, what to eat, how long to stay, when to exercise. In other words, the state tries to teach them too late. The prisoners are simply young men and women, and some in cases older men and women, who did not have proper parenting. So they end up in prison. And the prison's job is to try and teach them manners and morality and values. And by the time they're 30, 40, 50 years old, it is so tough to change hard cement. Very serious. What's the role and the priority of the family? Read it aloud, please, together. Go. Malachi 4, verse 5 says what? See, I will send you the prophet Elijah before that great and dreadful day of the Lord when it comes. He will do what? Turn the hearts of the fathers to their children and the hearts of the children to their fathers, or else I will come and strike this country with a curse. God says, look, if you don't get those families back together, the country will be under a curse. This prophecy is about Jesus Christ and John the Baptist. And it says that when the Messiah comes, his focus will be on bringing the hearts of the fathers back to their children and the children back to their fathers, so that the land will not be under curse. In other words, when a land seems to be under curse, God says it's the result of the families not being in order. I put it to you, Ephesians 6 verse 4 says what? Out loud. Fathers, do not exasperate your children. Instead, bring them up how? In the training and in the instruction of the Lord. Everybody say amen. Amen. I like this. No, notice now, the Bible says the fathers must train the children. It's very important. I want to show you something about training a child. This is very important. Can I have one of you guys come help me, please? Come here, Dave. The Bible says fathers should what? Train the child. Okay, I want Dave to stand right here facing that way, please. Okay, can I have three of you men come here, please? And just put your hand on his shoulder. All right, one more, please. Okay, just put two hands, right? Behind his shoulder. All right. Now, when I studied trains, I was shocked. The Bible says, fathers, train your children. And then the book of Proverbs says, train your children I found that when you have a train, the word used for train is interesting. The only thing that is called a train is the thing in front. It's the motor. Everything else is called cars. Are you with me? So only the engine part is called the train. The things that connect to it are called cars. Which means if the Bible says, fathers, you must train your children in the way they must go, then that means the father ain't supposed to, you let them go, go in the back of them and push them. Go to church. Go to prayer meeting. Go to prayer before you go to bed. Go read the Bible. He ain't supposed to be pushing them. He don't drop them off to church. They see you all after I play soccer. Or after I play dominoes, I'll pick you all up after I go to watch the ball game. See, that ain't training. That's pushing. The training is when you come back to the front and you hook your kids, your wife up to you, and you say, wherever I take this car, that's where it goes. If you ain't married today, young ladies, and a young man wink at you, check the tracks he's on. But let me see the track, where it's leading us. When a man tells you that he wants to marry you, he's asking you to leave your house and hook up to him. And if he ain't going nowhere, you are on your way nowhere. Clap, good place to clap, that's right. The family's supposed to train. The father's supposed to train the child. In other words, the way you build a family is by the father saying, follow me. If I drink, you drink. If I cuss, you cuss. If I smoke dope, you smoke dope. That's how powerful a father is. I go to prayer meeting. Let us go. I'm going to worship God for corporate worship. Come, let us go. I am going to pray tonight. Come pray with me. I read the word. Come on, read the word. In other words, whatever you do, you are pulling your family along. Matter of fact, in most cases, what we have is a woman behind all of this. And she ain't built to push it. See? And come here. I need a lady. Come here. I want you to see how ridiculous this looks. Because that's what God is saying he doesn't want. See? This woman, not only is she on the front, she in the back, and she's trying to force the boys and the husband to go to church. Push. See? Look at that. Isn't that stupid? That's the Bahamian home right there. Praise God, have mercy on us. Don't go yet. I want to show you how we're supposed to correct it. Now, can anyone tell me how to correct that? What do you do? Put her where? He said, put it in the front. You need to pray. I got to pray for you, man. Okay, put it in the front. Put it in the front. Let's see. Put it in the front. Put it in the front. Now, you're definitely a Bahamian. You are a true Bahamian. You need prayer. That is what Bahamians look like, just like that, too. Dragging the husband to church. Dragging the kids. The pressure on that woman. See, look at that. That's the family right there. Now, let's try it again. Where do we put her? No, right behind. Ah, she's right behind the man. That's a powerful woman. She simply hooks up and says, baby, let's go for the ride. And that's why some women actually let him go by himself, because she didn't want him to go where he headed. Come on, some of you ladies know what I'm talking about. That's called a divorce, eh? Let me tell you what most women do. Most women do this. Peep around, look in the front. No, at the truck. See, that's how most women look, just like that. Look again. That's how most women live. Where you taking me? I didn't bargain for that. Where you going? Most women. And when she figure out where he going, she do like this. That's called a single parent home. She ain't built to carry the load. That's why the Bible says, I want to restore the hearts of what? The fathers back to the children, and the children back to the fathers. That's the healing of the home. Thank you very much, family.
Very important. Colossians 3 verse 21. Out loud. Pray. Go. Fathers, do not embitter your children or they will become discouraged. Embitter means you tell them one thing, but you do the next. You tell them one thing, you do the next. You tell them one thing, you do the next. You keep contradicting what you're saying to your kids. You can't do that. You will cause them to be what? Bitter. And when you have bitter kids, you're going to have a criminal in society. Because they can take it out of on the community. Very important. All right, let's close this up with some thoughts here. Deuteronomy 11, verse 19. Out loud, read, go. Teach them to your children. Talk about them when you sit down at home, when you walk along the road, when you lie down, and when you get up. Look at this. Verse 20, go. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates, so that your days and the days of your children may be many in the land that the Lord swore to give to you and your forefathers, as many as the days that the heavens are above the earth. God said, look, if you teach your kids the word of God, I will make sure you live long. And your kids will live long. And you'll have a longevity in your home. In other words, he will keep sickness and cancer and high blood pressure and diabetes from your house if you teach your kids the word. Could you imagine God put health along with good manners? Many of our families are sick young. I mean breast cancer, all kinds of problems, because of the stress in the family. And it's very important that God connects the two. He said, you teach your kids the words and the morals and the values of God's word, and I will make sure your family live long. My father did a good job. He's 81 today, Daddy? 81 in May. I mean, he lived in some of my years. But that's because he and my mom taught us the word. And God will keep you alive. He says, I'll make you live long to see your grandchildren, your great-grandkids. What a pleasure it is for you to live that long. Look at this list very quickly. Write this down, please. The purpose for the family is, number one, socialization. You shouldn't need to learn socializing outside the home first. How many kids learn socialization on the blocks? You're supposed to learn to be sociable in the home. Number two, the family is supposed to also teach you civilization. To be civil. How to live with people who are different from you and not be mad at them. How to sleep in the bed with somebody and not feel like you're better than them. How to share something at the table. Or how to allow another one in the family to speak and you keep quiet and listen. In other words, they teach you how to be civil. Most of our criminals are uncivilized people. I heard Dr. Allen yesterday on the news say something, one of our psychologists here. He said, the criminals today are a little worse than the ones before. He said, when they come in to rob you, they ask for your money. After you give them the money, they still shoot you. In other words, they are totally uncivilized. It frightens me to think that you can go and live in that kind of society. The family is supposed to teach you how to be civil. How to argue without killing each other. How to have a disagreement without destroying one another. You learn that in a family. And you know, I was born into a little nation. You know that, right? 11 kids is a nation. And that's why I'm such a nice guy. Because you had to fight for the chicken neck if you wanted it, you know. If you didn't get it, you'd learn how to, you know, satisfy with the chicken hit, whatever it was we got left. Don't laugh at me. Some of you are rich. I wasn't that rich. Praise God. I used to like the hip anyhow. I had a lot of fat in it. Praise God. Anyone know what I'm talking about? That's the best part. See, these are real people. These are real people. You're all eating breasts and things. That boring meat. I like the real, you know, oily stuff. Mwah. You know what I'm talking about, right? Yeah, you know. Yes, you know just what I'm talking about. Yeah, especially when it's fried crispy in the Jesus' mighty name. Yes, sir. Holy hip. Praise God. Pray over it and eat it in Jesus' name. The family. They take the skin off. That's the best part of the chicken. Until you're 40 years old. Praise God. The family is also there for preservation. It preserves you and preserves society. Number four, and this is important. The family also provides identification. You get your identity in the family. If you didn't get it in the family, you can try getting it in a gang or in society. My father and mom made us feel important in the family. So when I went to school, I didn't do dumb things to try to feel important. See, a lot of folks are doing some rough, crazy things because they never got the personal identity in the house. So now they're trying to get in society, so they would kill someone, shoot someone, beat someone, steal something. Or, you know, do something someone wants to make them feel important. They join a gang. The gang says, look, If you want to become important, you got to break into that store. So he never got importance in the house, so he has to get it by breaking into the store so he can be accepted by this gang, and therefore his initiation becomes what he calls his identity. What a sad thing, he never got it in the family. Some folks try to get it in marriage. Never got it in the home, they try to get it in a marriage, it doesn't work, because ain't nobody give you identity in a marriage. And so you have problems in the home because the family didn't provide that solution. Next is procreation. The family provides an environment for procreation, for bringing up kids, for producing kids. And then the next is classification. The family is supposed to teach you how to classify yourself. In other words, I was number six in the family. I knew who I was very clearly. So the older ones made me clean the dishes, and I made the younger ones clean it for me. Anybody have made them deals with it? Yeah? Yeah, you know, you clean it for me, I'll give you, you know, a couple of shilling. But you see, you learn to accept different classifications through the family. So therefore, you don't end up getting angry when people are ahead of you or behind you or whatever. You understand that that's what life is about within the family. The family is supposed to teach you as an incubator. The family is supposed to incubate you psychologically. Also, the family is supposed to be a place where you learn accommodation. How to accept differences. Your sister ain't like you. You ain't like your sister, but you don't make her an enemy. You learn to accept that, hey, you are different. I accommodate your differences. I can get along with you because you're different. You're supposed to learn that in the family. If you don't learn in the family, you can learn it by fighting on the streets. See, and then this one is very important. Liberation. The family gives you the freedom to be yourself. You're supposed to learn to be different and enjoy it and have people accept you as being different in the family. If you don't learn in the family, then society has a problem. Very important. And the last one is transformation. The family is the place where you're supposed to be transformed and developed progressively through your years. Your family is the one that tells you you are only 16, you are not 26. You do not need a boyfriend now. See, the family helps you to transform slowly, see? Some folks want to be husband at 10 and wife at 6. You just can't do that. The family says, look, you are a child. So, you know, if you don't have a family to monitor you, you end up having babies at 16. I'm talking about four babies. And now we got difficulty in society. We got to dump your babies on the government. We got to pay taxes to take care of them babies for welfare. And now you become a stress on society, a difficulty in community, and also those kids grow up becoming criminal elements. You create a problem because the family was not there to help you transit slowly and say, look, you are a child at 16. You are still growing up. Don't come to me talking about you want to get engaged at 10. You, what are you talking about? Get engaged to your schoolwork. So that the family helps to transform you slowly through the process. If you have a good family, here's what it's supposed to produce. Write this down as your targets. Number one, responsibility. Number two, accountability. Number three, respectability. Number four, morality. Number five, communicability. Teach you how to communicate. Number six, values. Number seven, emotional shelter for you. Number eight, a natural psychological incubator. Teach you how to be psychologically sound. Some people are psychologically misfits because the family was not the right incubation for them. Number nine, the family provides self-concept for you and self-worth. And number 10, the family provides convictions and beliefs for your life. You learn them from your family. And if you don't believe in God, it could be because your father and mother didn't believe in God. Whatever your convictions are, usually come from your family environment. Very important. You writing too slow? Buy the tape or CD after the service, all right? Some of y'all are smart. Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 9. Am I going too fast for you? Okay. Am I really going too fast? All right. We'll give you 2 seconds for this one. Everything in the family is necessary for those things to happen. You're supposed to be incubated by the family to have a balanced emotional life. And if you came from a situation where it is not functional, you end up with many of these problems in society. Respectability, for example, I learned to respect authority from my family. So if you didn't learn respect for authority from your family, it's very difficult for you to respect your pastor. Some people call it by my first name. Why? Because in their family they call people by their first name. I'd be killed if I called my parents by their first name. I mean killed, buried. Imagine, did my sister, she tell you, can you imagine calling my daddy Matt? My daddy will kill me and tell God I died.
Not because, you know, we couldn't, but he was teaching us how to respect authority. You don't just call an older person by their first name. The Bible says, let the elders be respected by the youngers. That's a command from the book of Timothy. God says, look, respect your elders. So you become familiar with them to the point where you call your mother Cheryl. Are you crazy? Have a knock shell out of your mouth. That's your mother. She's not in your class. So all these things of respect got to be taught in the family. Now, if you don't respect people in your family, you can't respect your teacher in the classroom. You won't respect the policeman when he says stop. Or when you see the red light, you go through it. Why? You're not taught to respect authority. The red light is authority. I remember when I first ran my first red light, I was depressed for 3 days. I mean depressed. I was so guilty. I kept thinking, oh my God. And it wasn't that my parents or police saw me. I knew God saw me run that red light. Because I had learned to respect authority. And the red light meant, that's an authority. Here you are working in the bank, you didn't learn authority. And they got you counting the cash. Come on, talk to me. You'd say, my goodness, whoo, I ain't never seen more money in my life. And you know, this bank rich, I see $1,100 bills. They ain't gonna miss one. So you got it all worked out. But that's because you never learned to respect authority. I remember when I first sucked that sweet milk condensed can. Mwah! Ooh, glory, that was an anointed feeling, I tell you. I took that sweet milk. Anybody have no sweet milk? I was drinking that up, and I didn't want to drink all, see? Because I just wanted a little bit. And I started to suck it, and I kept sucking. And I said, okay, I should stop now, but just a little bit more. And I heard, and I knew I'm in trouble. So you know me, I'm a genius, right? So I went to the tap. What are you laughing at? Why are you all laughing? Anyone ever done this before? All those honest people, hold your hand up. Come on, help me out here. Okay, I'm not alone. Thank you. I filled it up with water. Put it back in the refrigerator. Man, listen. And I was just waiting for someone to go, ah! About an hour later, I hear somebody say, this is not milk. I say, oh my God, I'm being discovered. They were pouring it, you see, something. Water came out. And so, you know, our parents are real cool. You know, my mother and father say, okay, everybody line up. I'm number six, you know, in the middle. Yes, sir. Yeah. And they went through the questions. Okay, who did this? And I'm the first one. Not me! Mom said, it's you. Anybody know what I'm talking about? You look like you know what I'm talking about, right? Yes, sir. The first one is the guilty one who makes the most noise. Not me. Yes, it's you. Me, I ain't never done that. Let me tell you, one time I got whooping so bad for that, I never sucked milk again. Even today, when I'm in my own house with my own milk, I'm afraid to suck it. It's my house, my refrigerator, my milk. I can drink this. And I'm thinking, I'm going to get whooping by my wife. The best one of all, don't laugh at this, is when I stole X-Lax. Help me out, somebody. Come on, help me out. Chocolate, I thought. Chocolate. Ooh, I found chocolate. Anybody ever found chocolate? Yes, sir. And I took a little piece. I said, am I going back for more? I went back 4 or 5 times, all gone. You know what I'm talking about? Yes, sir. And I'm happy, man. My mouth's sweet. And my mother says, who removed this extract? Amy. And everybody arguing, ain't them. Mom says, we'll find out. 2 o'clock in the morning, she caught me in the bathroom. Oh, it's you. She say, Tyus? Tyus means that's my daddy. I know who it is. Imagine getting whooping on the inside and the outside. There's too much whooping. Clap your hands. Thank God for freedom. They whooped me. Never had an X-lax. It was an X-lax forever. It was X. Never touched it again. But I learned to respect authority by getting corrected from sucking the milk. So when I work in a store and got to count money, I respect other people's property because they taught me to respect our own in the house. And that's how you learn to bring a family up. Very important. Deuteronomy 4 verse 9. Read out loud. Go. Only be careful and watch yourselves
So that you do not forget the things your eyes have seen, or let them slip from your heart as long as you live. Teach them to your children and to their children after them. Very important. The function of the family, therefore, is to transmit culture, to transmit values, to transmit morals, to transmit principles, to transmit authority, and to transmit belief systems. The family is key. You're writing too slow, eh? That is what the family is for. That's a big job. And if we're going to heal our countries and strengthen our kids and give us good spirits for our family, we're going to have to develop these commitments. We've got to commit ourselves to build a strong culture to our families. Out loud, let's read it together, please. This is the conclusion of the matter. What families are supposed to do. Read. The purpose for the family is to reproduce, secure, preserve, develop, provide for the maximization of the functional potential of the individual within the context of the whole, so that one can function effectively and efficiently in life and in society. That's what families are for. They are to produce an individual that is sane and helpful to society, not a problem to society. It's supposed to produce authority and submission, obedience and respect, accountability, responsibility, time, management. In other words, the family teaches you how to use your time. Go to bed on time. Get up on time. Time to do your homework. Watch TV for an hour. In other words, they teach you to manage your time. And when your parents are gone, you have that value system in your life. It also gives you communication and tolerance. The family helps you to tolerate people, to tolerate differences. If you never learned it in the family, you're going to fight in community to try and learn it. It's going to be a problem. The family also teaches you how to be cooperative. Cooperate with people. Be loving with those who don't have the same views you have. The family is supposed to teach you how to be that way. The family is so key to our society. The family is supposed to teach you to be disciplined. Supposed to teach you to be financially a manager. How to develop relationships. How to have morals and values that can strengthen your home, and how to have a good character. The family also teaches spirituality. You also gain from the family the sense of forgiveness. How to forgive people. When somebody hurts you in the family, you don't hold it up for them for 40 years. You forgive people in the family. And when you go outside, somebody hurts you, offend you, you can forgive them as well. The family taught you that. Also love and affection, touching, hugging, expressing to someone that you love them. The family is supposed to teach you that. How many men in this home, in this building right now, difficulty telling their wives they love them? Because the family never made that a part of their experience. And so when you tell your husband, why don't you say you love me?
Well, my father never told my mom I love her.
See, he got it from his family. And you're wondering, maybe this man is brutal. No, he isn't. He hasn't been cultured properly. Don't let it happen in your family. If your father never touched you, make sure you touch your son. Hug your daughter. Bless your children. Why? You want to change the culture that you came out of. See, because their family communicates that in a strange and a strong way. Ephesians 3 verse 14. Read out loud, please. For this reason, I kneel before the Father, from whom his whole family in heaven and on earth derives his name. And here's the key. You can become a part of the biggest family in the world. It's the family of God. This is why we invite you here to this house. This house is called the house of God. And the house of God is the house where the Father God invites all of us to come. Today, maybe you are not a part of a perfect family. Well, welcome to the party. There are thousands here today who are not part of a perfect family. But there is a perfect family that you can be a part of. And that is the family of God. He's a forgiving God. He loves you. He died on the cross to redeem you back to his family. And everything that he has done has been so that he can bring you back to the family. I want you to spend this moment before we get together and start giving out some prizes. I want to give you the first prize we have today. The first prize is a free gift of forgiveness. Maybe you've not done a good job as a father or a mother, or maybe even as a son or daughter, you've not been the best in your home. I'd like for us to be very still right now, and let's think about what God wants to do in our lives individually. Let's bow our heads together. No one looking around, please. I want to pray with you and pray for you. Thank you. Thank you, Lord.
Oh, how he loves you and me.
Father, in your name, I bring these families in this building today, fathers and mothers, grandfathers, grandmothers, great-grandfathers and mothers, sons and daughters, nephews, nieces, cousins, uncles, adopted sons and daughters, widows and widowers. Father, you love all. And you gave your life for each one of them, so they can be restored back to the best family in the world, the family of God. I pray for those watching even by television now, that they will feel your love and your care for each soul. And Lord, today many have come because of invitation. But let us be the best invitation of all, that they come not to this place, but they come back to you. Lord, we've not done a good job at our families, many of us. We've not done a good job. And our parents didn't do a good job in some cases, but we forgive them right now. We release them from any bitterness that we have in our hearts. We forgive them. We are going to be better parents. We're going to be better children to our fathers and mothers. Help us to respect authority. Help us to submit ourselves to your work. And now your kingdom is available today to receive us. I pray for you, Lord God. I pray that each soul would hear your voice, and that you would speak to them in the depths of their hearts. With your heads bowed and no one looking around, I want to just give you a personal invitation to make a recommitment to the Father of Heaven. Maybe you've not received Him as your Lord 100%. Maybe you've been religious. Maybe in the past you've been in churches and trying to find something to do, but today you have realized that you cannot do this without Him, and that He gave His life for you to become a good citizen of His kingdom first. And you'd like to rededicate your life to Him. You'd like to be restored back to Him. A young man, a young woman, a father, a mother, a grandparent. If you would like to make this day is your day, the sixth day of this new month. The first Sunday in March is when you made a decision to receive and accept His love, to build a strong family. If you want to do that right now, keep your heads bowed, please. I want to pray for you. Just lift your right hand and say, Pastor Miles, I want that. I want to rededicate my life back to Him. If that's you, lift your hand and put it right back down right now. I want to pray for you specifically. Lift it up, put it back down. God bless you. Anyone else? God bless you. God bless you. Come on, just keep your heads bowed, please. Make it a personal decision. I rededicate my life back to God. Any other hands? Lift it up. I want to see them, please. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Yes, God bless you. Anyone else? Fathers, rededicate your life to the Lord. Break the curse over your life. God bless you, brother. God bless you, brother. God bless you, sister. God bless you, ma'am. God bless you, sir. God bless you, young man. God bless you, madam. God bless you. So many hands going up. Praise God. Today, if you'd like to rededicate your life to Him, maybe you backslid. Maybe you're away from God and you want to come back today to bring your family back in order. You know where you are with God. Will you do it today? Lift your hand up right now and say, yes, I want to rededicate my life to Christ. Put it back down. God bless you, brother. God bless you, ma'am. God bless you. God bless you, mom. God bless you, sir. Anyone else? Quickly, please. Rededication of my life to the Lord. God bless you. God bless you, sir. God bless you. God bless you, young man. God bless you, sir. God bless you, ma'am. God bless you, sir. God bless you. So many. Praise. Father, thank you for these hands. What a beautiful sight. Lord, I pray that you will take each hand and write it in your book. Let them be aware of your love for them. This is the day of the family. I give you praise. Heal our countries by healing the family. In Jesus' mighty name I pray. A personal blessing upon each one of them. Hallelujah. If you held your hand up today, we want to pray with you personally, like I said. So just lift your hand up again, but stand up this time.
Jesus.
Stand up if you held your hand up, please. I want to pray for you personally. All right, all over the place. Look at him getting up. Praise God. Come on, stand up. If you held your hand up for either one of those calls, lift your hand up, then stand up, please, with me. Praise God. That's it. Don't be afraid. Let's give these folks a big hand for being honest with God. Honest with God. Honest with God. Honest with God. I said the angels are rejoicing. Praise God. Wow, what a good sight. Let me just ask one more question. Some of you young people here today, not married, but you'd like to rededicate your life to the Lord to make sure that you have the kind of family He intended. You want to surrender your future life to Him. I want you to stand up as well and join these people. Pastor Miles, I want a good family. I want the best family God intended. If that's your prayer, will you stand up and also join these people? I want to pray for you that you would have the kind of family we heard about today in the Word. A family that teaches its kids the Word and teaches values that will last. God bless you. God bless you. Wow, what a beautiful thing. All of you are standing. I remember when I was a young teenager, I received Christ at age 13. I remember reading a book, and it says in this book, the book of Matthew, it says, if you be ashamed to declare me before men, I will be ashamed to declare you before my Father who is in heaven. Wow. I tell you, that changed my life. I've never been afraid since then to publicly declare that I believe what I stood up for. I want you to step out of your seat. Get your Bible and your purses, whatever you have, and come out front here, all of you standing, and stand with one of these ministers and let them declare with you in faith your commitment to Christ. Come on, right now. We're going to clap as you come. Let them out of the seat, and I want someone to walk with you. Come on, saints. Don't let anyone walk with you by themselves. You Christians, you walk with them. Love God's image. Love God's image. Love God's image. Love that image. No one walks alone up here. Come on, you men and women of God. You see somebody walking by themselves, get up and go stand with them. Because they are God's image. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, what a beautiful sight. Come on, give them another hand. Praise God for rededication, salvation, and restitution in Christ. Thank you, Lord.
He loves me. How He loves you and me.
Look at it again. Sing one more time. Oh, how.
Oh, how He loves you and me.
Oh, praise God. Father, we pray for each one of these that their lives will never be the same. I want every counselor to make their way to the front. I want every person to be prayed for individually. I want every home here to be blessed, to be spoken over in faith. Every spirit of hunger be filled today by the power of God today. Oh, how He loves you. How He loves me. How He loves you. Thank you, Lord, for these families. Thank you for rededication of these homes, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
Can you reach? Just take your hands and point toward them right now, please. All of us who are seated down in the chairs, and begin to pray for your family while you pray for theirs right now. Come on, pray for your fathers and mothers, your brothers and sisters who are not here today. Maybe they're back home in America, in Canada, or in Haiti. Or in maybe Guyana or Barbados somewhere. Pray for your family while you pray for these people. Ask God to touch your family and bring them back to Him. Restore families back in Jesus' name. To give them a second chance. Pray for those families in Jesus' name. Come on, pray for your children. Pray for your spouse. Pray for the spouse to become the one you're dreaming of. Pray the Lord will give you the right person. That your home will be built on His values and His standards and His morals. The kingdom of God would come to these families. We pray for every home, Lord God. Every home in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord God.
We give you thanks, Lord, for answering every prayer in the name of Jesus. You want every card filled out today, please, counselors. Fill out every card that we have. We want to get these names so we can pray for these people. Where are the counselors and the cards? I want the cards to be filled out now. We want to remember them, pray for them every week. We want to put them on our prayer list. We want to keep them in our prayers. So please, quickly, fill out every card. I want every card filled out. Names, addresses, we want to pray for them. Every counselor, please fill out the card so we can pray for these people every day. We're going to be on our prayer list. I'm so glad you're here today. This is the heart of God. He brought you here for this moment. He brought you here for this day. Wow, what a blessing. Quickly, please, fill out every card, please. Where are the cards, please? Can you burn, pass them up, please? We need some cards over here. I don't see any over here, praise God. Hallelujah. Everyone, want the names? We want to pray for them. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. There are no cards over here. No cards over here. What more could he do? Oh, how he loves me. Oh, how hallelujah. He loves me. Thank you, Jesus. Just remain seated, please, for a minute. Let these people continue the ministry. No movement except those up front, please. Let's stay in order. Bye.